speaker tonight is Irinca Damian from the University of Bucharest. Her title is Representations and Inventions, a Bridge Between Art and Science. Irinca, please.
Thank you. So, my name is Irinca Damian. I'm a PhD student at the Faculty of Philosophy here. My research area is anthropology of art. And previously, my studies include masters in history of art, philosophy of culture, art conservation, and painting. When I was a kid, I was drawing a lot. Drawing is basically what I remember from my childhood. I would be drawing even when I started school, and I would be drawing during classes, and basically this made me end up studying art. And all this time I kept asking, why do I keep doing this? Why do I draw? And after studying a lot about what other people draw, paint, sculpt, everything they invented in order to keep doing this, my question became, why do people keep making art? I strongly believe that the question, what is art, the question that is commonly put when speaking about the subject, is not very well addressed. Although artistic creation is a universal behavior, this question still has no universally accepted answer. A more accurate question would be, why do people keep making this? I started my PhD thesis questioning the resemblance between artistic objects under the theoretical paradigm of cultural diffusion, but soon it developed into being a study on image making. In order to better understand the diffusion phenomenon, namely the manner in which artistic images travel from one culture to another in the context of their direct interaction, the first thing one can do is question how images are made. Image making can be roughly described as the process in which a visual representation comes into being, its development as a physical object. The term was used with this approach by Winnie Davis in The Origins of Image Making, a 1986 paper. He develops here a definition of the pictorial image as an intentional act, developed late in the human evolution as a part of a specialized process of reduction and decomposition of the human vision. Humans developed the ability to use non-representational marks, such as lines and blots of color, to compose pictorial images that refer to an object. This can be achieved only because we have this ability to decompose and decompose the reference objects in part that can be symbolized. Representation is a tool for the eye, says Davis, and it is used in abstracting, simplifying, and maybe understanding the world. The main quality of a pictorial representation is it being partially dependent upon perceptual identities with the subject, but partially detached, non-identical. And I use this image to better explain the concept. Like, line itself is abstract. It doesn't represent anything. It represents itself. It also is not seen in the outside world, the external world. It's basically a limit, a contour, and also the blot of color, which was initially used to define certain spaces, certain areas within a community. And these developed into representing something we conceive as being dancers or human figures, or more of a concept than actual being. The concept of artistic representation being first of all conceptual provides us with a different starting point when thinking about images. Namely, one should search inside the human mind and its processes in order to better understand the artistic behavior as a result of it. There is a process of image making. It involves our mind, our intentions and desires, and also practical tools and knowledge of the properties of certain things, materials, our intuition, our ability to contextualize. For my research, I structured this process into three main phases. The mental image making, where the representation is being conceptualized, the process of depiction, the representation is actually created, gains a physical form, and meaning making. And I use this image because it's an X-ray, half the final painting from Rembrandt. And on the X-ray you can see the initial drawing, namely it was being modified until it ended up having different features. The mental image making. Here I analyze how the representation of an object comes into being in our mind. Although the view supported by most theoreticians of the subject is that we see a form of the subject we intend to make, recent studies bring forward the idea of a preconceptual stage in representation development. The preconceptual stage. Zenon Felishin developed the visual indexing theory, which states the existence of a level of perception that is preconceptual. A summary would be that early vision processes segment the visual field into feature clusters that tend to be reliable proximal counterparts of distinct individual objects in the distal scene. Recently activated clusters compete for a pool of four or five indexes, and FINST index is an instrument of reference by which one can pick out and refer to things. It's mostly like a descriptive, but it helps the mind follow an object and achieve properties and allows a person to think about something in the world that was selected in perception because it drew attention to itself. For example, here we have two identical triangles. An artificial intelligence would not see this as two identical, but as a triangle. We make the difference that here are if we see one and then the other, and also if we see both triangles, we can understand that these are two because we have this kind of FINST index. In this assignment is primarily stimulus driven, although cognitive factors might have a limited effect, like the focal attention. Indexes keep being bound to the same individual of visual objects as the latter change their properties and location within certain as yet unknown constraints. Only indexed objects can enter into subsequent cognitive processes, such as recognizing their individual or relational properties, or shifting focal attention, or gaze, or making other motor gesture towards them. Pilishin argues that a small number of objects from our visual field are being selected and segmented without cognitive or conceptual intervention. Moreover, indexes are assigned to these objects, now identified as individuals. The individuals are being tracked and properties are assigned to them under certain conditions. Only these individuals, that are very few comparative to the amount of our visual field, enter can be further further conceptualize, describe, define, and act upon. The second stage would be the conceptual stage, or some of the very few that are indexed enter a conceptual stage where they are visually represented in order to become what we would call artistic objects. So, even if we see an amount of objects, from those we even less we end up making artistic objects starting from them. They may achieve a visual form. Even now, the visual form is not very well defined, and the index properties have a bigger influence than the mental visual stage. The conceptual form refers to the properties achieved in the pre-conceptual stage to the individual selected from the visual field. It gains different definitions corresponded with the properties, maybe the spatial, temporal, cultural, a very specific way of one's mind in selecting information from the visual field. In this moment, the mental representations start being visualized inside one's mind, but it's more a concept of the object than the power of the mind sending for the external object, like in the intentionality. If we are to use Hegel's approach, here is where the genius is stimulated by an object and provides a state of inspiration where one's mind starts developing an image that might have aesthetic properties, but more importantly would have a specific meaning. An artistic product, what once mentally conceived, demands its creation in a physical form along with its specific meaning. A contrary in defining a human shape would mean a hunter, a priest, a dancer, a soul, a certain merchant, and so on. The technical stage, once charged with this burden of creating a mental conception, one's mind will start searching for tools. There are two kinds of tools, the non-representational tools, line and color, the inventions and the inventions experimentally developed and enriched in time in order to make artistic products. Brushes, mixture of pigments, mediums, different building materials, panels, fabrics, so on. Here the mind plans the creation of the object in more or less detail. In any case, here is when we acknowledge the use of line, color, and we select the technical inventions needed. The second phase would be the process of depiction. And here I used, it's kind of dark, wasn't supposed to be that dark, the image. Here I used, throughout my presentation, I used very common, well-known artworks because it's easier to refer. And in this stage, the maker starts working at what will become the art object. I consider this process to be dynamic as the object is still being adjusted and modified while it is being created. The maker must have some sort of access to previous knowledge, a database of both techniques and depictions of the said subject, be they general, portrait, human body, or particular, a depiction of a certain character or god, or already depicted idea, concept. In any case, the maker will search for the knowledge and tools needed or will invent them. If the maker is supposed to represent something that is already depicted, we might consider the maker being already guided towards a destination already known. But because the maker has an external image of what he is supposed to do. A question and an observation arises. If the depiction already exists, in our case the Last Supper, why the maker will continue their mission of doing it? So again, why do people keep making art? And the observation is that there are no two identical objects in the world except for the copies who are intentionally made as such, and even those bear certain differences. Even if an image of something already exists, the maker will not consider it being valid, so they will keep proceeding with their own version. There are as many variables on a subject as there are minds conceptualizing it. The art object is a physical impression of this series of variables and is interconnected with other art objects through resemblance and with the subject through reference. I chose to illustrate this process with Leonardo da Vinci's Last Supper, because he has a lot of preliminary sketches with the composition, with certain character, with certain details, the most important ones like Judas or Christ. Judas is here. He made a lot of sketches, and also for the Last Supper he modified the fresco technique. So this is one very good example of an artist searching for the tools, searching for the perfect composition. It happens in any process of basically realizing the art object. This process is mental and practical. The process of depiction aren't really clearly defined, as the mind will continue achieving information or searching for new solutions as it is depicted. But in the end, we have a final product, which in any case is not the initial idea by the book. It's not identical to the idea in the maker's head. I consider this process to be dynamic because it is still mentally conceived, and a proof would be previous sketches or version of the same idea, visible modifications done by the maker during his work, as I shown previously with Rembrandt's piece. I must add here the importance of inferring the maker's process when seeing the final product. For one who has knowledge of the subject or a very powerful intuition, the final product of an artistic endeavor bears in a visible manner all the phases involved and all the solutions found by the maker. So one can not only make the said project once again, but more importantly, one can find new solutions, better approaches. Many artistic objects are produced in this manner, this practice making room for the idea of an evolution of artistic representation. But I consider this practice to be better understood as a phenomenon than as the artistic endeavor in its entirety. The meaning making, the final phase of an image making process, refers to how we understand this. After it is completed by the maker and given to the world to see, the object will achieve meaning from different actors. The first meaning maker is the actual maker, who uses the common framework of the symbol system valid in their historical and cultural area. By using certain symbols, they will trigger certain responses from the viewers. This can be considered to be the intended meaning. In some cases, it might bear a degree of uncertainty, because sometimes the makers aren't really sure and can't really name their product. The second meaning maker is the viewer, who has the power of accepting or denying the existence of the object in accordance with their personal concept of the object seen. Here is where the object gains value, becomes an artistic object. It is considered good or bad, beautiful, unworthy. Here is where the artistic value lies, aesthetic value lies. And as time goes by, other viewers will accept or deny it by giving further meanings to it. From these meanings, other art objects can appear following the path described above in its entirety. In this moment in history, we are seeing more artworks that weren't destined for our sight or even for human sight, see the funerary art objects, but then objects that are clearly destined for us and our world, the contemporary ones. We give meanings to all we see. The mere existence of an art object is dependent on our approval and our acceptance. We accept or deny. We can also destroy art objects we don't like, or just erase them from our mind. We accept and deny not for its resemblance with the outside world, which outside world, because if we can see the reference, we can compare to that, but for our interpretation of its reference. So why do we insist on resemblance? If we return to our scheme, we can see that the starting point of a representation is not the object, but clusters of features, attributes, properties that end up giving descriptions of what the object might be or look like, and what to do with it. Most important for the problem discussed now is the description of what one might do with, and what one thinks one sees. Sometimes one ends up having an artistic endeavor with what one thinks one sees. I insist on this construction, one thinks one sees, because it's about building the concept of what one sees. If one ends up making art out of this, one doesn't act upon the same thing. One doesn't recreate in a personal manner the same things. One invents, makes a concept of a thing, irrelevant to its appearance of the thing, or a completely abstract concept that doesn't even have a reference in the external world. One brings to the other members of the community and subsequently to the world an invention of his mind. Even more, one invents tools that are specially designed to make the process easier. The invention is the act of bringing ideas and objects together in a novel way to create something that did not exist before. The resemblance with the object is a great problem in visual art. It was and still is considered a defining element when discussing about it. The only heavily studied culture who managed to create a representational system based on apparent resemblance is the ancient Greek culture. In every place of the world, humans lived and they created something of artistic value everywhere on Earth, every historical time and place, in every civilization or small culture. Humans created something artistic. Greece is just a small dot in this world, and their method, that even if it was designed to respect resemblance, still depicted idealized versions, failed after a few hundred years, leaving room for a more idealized and stylized version of it, the Eastern Christian art. Even when rediscovered and reapproached during Renaissance in Western Europe, it failed in almost the same amount of time, a few hundred years, leaving room for a more abstract art. A representational system based on resemblance is doomed to fail because it forces a maker to abstract, select, decompose, recompose, with the aim of achieving external resemblance. If we take into consideration that our thinking process is not even that visual, considering the recent studies, But images are more a result of an abstract, non-figurative thinking process that accumulates information. What is resemblance? Resemblance can be taken into consideration only between objects belonging to the same category, in our case, artistic objects. Nelson Goodman states in Languages of Art that a Constable painting of Marlborough Castle is more like any other picture than it is like the castle. Yet it represents the castle, not another picture, not even the closest copy. The semiotic approach to visual art only focuses on symbol system and deciphering them. Visual art is a little more. Even Goodman in his book uses visual art to show what a notational system is not. As I stated before, a maker uses notations available to his peers. But this can be approached from two points of view. The first is that while growing up in a world that uses a certain symbol system, the mind will develop accordingly, selecting information and processing it in order to deliver something the maker was able to conceptualize. This might be why the isolated cultures develop a system of representation characterized by being unchanged for generations, while cultures that interact with others end up having a dynamic mode of representation subject to change even from a maker to the other. The second point of view is that the maker uses a symbol system available to their peers in order to communicate. And this view is supported mainly by symbolic anthropologists such as Clifford Geertz. If one focuses on the first point of view, the maker ends up with something similar because that was what he or she was able to conceive. One can consider that humans keep making art because they keep inventing their world. And so, the acknowledgement or denial of certain artistic objects becomes a reaction to the presented view of their world. I forgot to do this. So, can we consider art a form of science? The second issue in my title. Despite this apparently unorganized nature, given that many such inventions refer to the same thing or to things we might not understand, is art contributing to our knowledge of the world? In a historical sense, it is, given that we use artifacts and artistic objects to infer how the world functioned some time ago. But if we don't consider the historical, anthropological, and social scenes, what if art gives us an insight of minds instead of behaviors? What if artistic practice is a physical proof for certain modes of organizing the world? Feyerabend considers that the world is immensely abundant in his last book, and all we do is to abstract it and make it intelligible. Among our most used tools to capture abstraction is art in all its forms, be it poetry, see his approach to Achilles' discourse in Iliad, or fine art such as painting and use of perspective. Each culture has a version of the world which functions for them. Gods interfere in humans' activities. Heroes have ambiguous discourses. Humans end up representing their gods as humans. Humans end up creating perspective that functions only from certain points of view, and so on. The world functions just as well and is tamed by humans with their abstraction. Feyerabend considers mythology, art, and science being just as valuable as they are developed and are used by humans in their pursuit of making sense of a very abundant reality. The break between art and science developed in the approximately the last 200 years, along with a modern concept of the world, in which sciences are rational, directed towards progress, and arts and humanities are not. The approach artists had also in the last 100 years made the gap even bigger. Creating art for the sake of art, being extremely conscious of this, their status as artists, dreamers, and as outcasts. And science contributed to education in a manner in which education ended up being a tool in achieving a knowledge of practices proven to be accurate. The break between art and science is very new and of Western descent, taking into consideration the immense history of the world and its cultures. In my approach, I try to make sense of this gap. I consider visual art to be a component of our knowledge and our knowledge of the world, a tool as well invented as a mechanism that guides our lives. It might not help us progress, but it shows our progress. And it might not make our life easier, but it makes it bearable. And this would be close to all. I'm very thirsty. Our process in which we create images and subsequently art objects is very complex and not so visual as the art theoreticians consider. More we represent concepts, attributes, ideas, and it's about how we understand the world. And I work towards understanding how artworks resemble and why in that way or not the other. And this is why it sounded a little deconstructivist, but I hope it won't. It's not. For me, it's not so deconstructive. Thank you.
Question. Would you say there is also a break between the value of science and the value of art? I'm thinking on the lines that value of science is some objective thing, more objective than the value of art.
What would be the value of science?
Well, technology, let's say.
Yeah, making our life easier.
That would be one value, but it's not the only value. Yeah. Education is another one, which
education,
you pointed out.
Education, making our lives easier, more comfortable, helping us deal with the things we can't really do when left outside in the dark and without any tools. And art has a value that is aesthetic. It's beautiful and it's achieved value. I don't think it's an intrinsic value of art to be beautiful, to be aesthetic. And if I consider them to be...
If you think there's a break also there, I mean, are they fundamentally different?
They respond to different needs. There is a need of art, given that it's universal. And there is a need of knowing the world, given all the approaches to the world, be they mythological or scientific, as the Western world has. I don't like making comparisons and valuing making comparison between values, because maybe for some isolated culture, what we value very much, like our laptop, it's worthless. Is that it doesn't make their life easier because they don't use PowerPoint or internet. So.
I was wondering whether how do you take into account an art world that no longer takes beauty as its object? So let's say the end of
art in the
traditional sense, such that art becomes much more about putting concepts into friction, putting a certain kind of political critique or agenda onto to demonstrate contradictions within society, represent the unrepresentable, etc. Because you're presenting a very kind of like ahistorical concept of art, so that, you know, like at the earliest people and now basically have the same kind of evolutionary and psychological needs, but of course art has this kind of self-consciousness that is trying to expose itself all, I mean, you know, abolish that part of itself that's already been done.
Yeah, I think this self-consciousness of art is just as new as the modern world.
Mm-hmm.
And also I think the value of beauty is specific to Western culture. Like the Greeks have valued the beauty, and so did the Renaissance people, because from the Greeks to the Renaissance, there wasn't any, oh, we make this because it's beautiful, we make this because religious purposes, because we need to express and have an actual image of certain processes. So I think the value of beauty is really small, it's historical. Historical and cultural. And I use a historical approach because, yeah, if you go from culture to another and if you don't consider that ones are evolved and the others are primitive, you end up not seeing the evolution of history of art as we learn it, because that's only specific to us, to the Western world.
Then you get a kind of conceptual difference, because either you decide that it's about the definition also of the term beauty.
Yeah.
Right? So if the West philosophical discourse has defined beauty in a certain way, then that becomes like owned by, let's say, by the West, right? And then, but couldn't that aesthetic experience, whatever you want to call it, be also translated into another artistic tradition?
I'm not sure I follow.
Like, I don't know. Is Indian mandalas also beautiful? Or are they not?
They
were not made to be beautiful?
Their beauty, I think, is secondary. They are made on religious self-discovery processes. I didn't read a lot about mandalas, but...
No, I mean,
they don't do it because it's beautiful.
Yeah.
And...
Really?
Why
would they do it that way? You know, they can do a self-discovery simple way, you know, like, why did they have to develop that in this kind of one thing that you could experience as beautiful? No?
Yeah, I know, but I still think the value of beauty is secondary, is a result, is not in the means.
Another question. Most of what you've shown us is about painting and probably applies to poetry, I guess. Do you think it applies to music, which is much less conceptualized?
It is much more abstract from my point of view. No, I only work on images and I work with visual art form. That's what I'm studying of music and of other artistic practices.
Dance. I would think of music and dance.
I think it applies to a certain degree because you that mechanism I work on image making. I think it applies to other art forms, but I didn't study much on that. For me, music is much more abstract and much more notational, and easier to remake, although people, again, keep doing another type of music and music again. It belongs to the same approach somehow, but no, I didn't think it in regards to music. I only work with visual art forms and also representations that can be on panels, canvas, walls.
How about photography?
Photography is another medium and it goes way faster. You don't have that process when you can change and rework and redo. And if it's planned, like studio photography, you plan and then you search for the right angle. But if it's snapshot, like
There's also a dynamic process where photography changes painting. Right?
It is dynamic and it's a process that goes very fast. You see something or you think about something and you want it. And you conceive it in the studio and photograph, and maybe afterwards you work on the photo. So it can go inside this as well. No further questions?
If nobody wants, I have a very technical question. If you could go back to the slide, you had a slide, it was with Mona Lisa, I think, and...
Oh, a lot of Mona Lisas. This one?
No, previous one. It was about value.
Value?
Yeah, it was about makers making value and viewers making value.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Ah, okay, yeah, it's this one.
This one.
Right. So, I would not fully agree with what you say here, because I think there is also another source of value that's more elusive, and in order to see it, so let's imagine you are in the Louvre and it's at night, it's closed, and you replace the Mona Lisa with a copy, not perfect copy, average copy.
Mm-hmm.
So let's say you are the maker and you know it doesn't have any value, so you're not assigning it any value. It doesn't have any viewers, at least not yet. As soon as you open the museum, people will start coming in and they will stop and treat it like Mona Lisa, at least until somebody figures it out. So I would say that there is another social source of value that that kind of accounts for why would people still stop at that Mona Lisa.
Yeah, because Mona Lisa is widely known.
Yeah, but it's not really the Mona Lisa, the painting, that is known. It's Mona Lisa, a more abstract concept of Mona Lisa that is the one that's providing the value, no?
Yeah.
And it's actually a bit socially constructed. It's more than, it's
actually,
not the maker. The maker did not assign it that value.
I don't know. It was stolen from the museum. It was barely known, but when it was stolen and when they discovered it is stolen, I don't know, in the last 100 years, I don't know the year, it was such an immense panic that the Mona Lisa is gone, like a painting was gone, and it was all over the place, the fact that the Mona Lisa is gone, and that's how when it finally came back, because it was stolen from one of the guys who worked in the museum, and he had it in his house, because he wasn't able to sell it, because everyone knew that the Mona Lisa is stolen. When it came back, it gained this socially constructed value. Before that, it was barely known, and before that, it was in a private house, and it was made for a private owner. It was a portrait, and it wasn't even liked by the
Actually, you would say that being stolen increased its value.
Yeah, in the case of Mona Lisa, not being there increased its value.
Oh, that's...
Yeah, it's a very nice story. I should have read about that beforehand. before the presentation, because I don't know, I forgot the dates. I think in the 30s, something like that.
1911,
yeah.
August 21st.
You see, he's got the science of the internet.
And so in the case of Mona Lisa, it's basically a cultural object. That's why it was modified and acted upon, and you know, the mustaches and all the approaches, and that's one of my biggest dislikes, that some of the objects in the Western world are widely known. Like, you know, the Venus of Milo, you know, Mona Lisa and so on, but some of them are not so known, and maybe they have aesthetic value or historical value, or which that is more important than Mona Lisa, which was a portrait that was disliked when it was made. But yeah, we have a strange way in approaching art, and it's really peculiar.
But at that point, nobody goes to see the Mona Lisa because they think it's beautiful.
And then you go to see the Mona Lisa because it's the Mona Lisa. It's
a kind of
an
aura.
That's basically the contemporary approach. Right? You want something because it is a concept of it. You want a Van Gogh, not because you have a sudden feeling of beauty and the Stendhal. It's named the Stendhal syndrome, when you faint basically because of the beauty of the artwork. it's peculiar how we approach art and why.
So your idea is that art is not so different from science?
My idea is that art is a form of science in the matter that is a form of knowing, but in the same way it invents what it thinks it knows.
I can see that in the case of Leonardo with him drawing fantasy and so on. But besides him, I don't see how art improves knowledge in the sense in which science does.
I said at the end, it doesn't improve progress, because from science you want progress, you want better everything, no?
I want knowledge. And I don't see how art gives you a Rembrandt portrait or something, gives you knowledge of what?
Gives the merchant that ordered the portrait a clearly put input status that is external of him knowing and the others knowing that he's a merchant.
Yeah, but this kind of knowledge is different from the one that is given by science.
In the matter that science provides knowledge, that give me an example.
Say whatever you want from science.
I think the difference maybe is that knowledge, scientific knowledge, is theoretical, meaning you abstract some bit of truth from the world, whereas in art, you're creating, you're putting something into the world.
Yeah.
So you're making something. So it's non-theoretical in the sense that you can't just leave it. You know, it's, you're injecting, you're creating something.
Yeah, and
it's techne and episteme.
Techne and episteme, that's exactly what I'm saying.
Yeah,
that's
exactly. But,
Could you be wrong in art?
No.
I would think that this is the most the greatest gap from science.
You end up giving something that is completely different, but not wrong.
Yeah,
and in science,
in science, you could be wrong. I mean, you could have a theory that is wrong. It doesn't predict the phenomenon. Yeah.
But it's totally can be wrong in art. I mean, it's early modern art theories, they write that artists do not transmit the knowledge in the proper way because they don't respect certain laws of art and because they don't organize the picture rationally and because the light doesn't create
the
a
composition
legible image.
The structure that for some reasons gives the impression that you like or dislike something. So in this way, because it's, if a painting is badly composed and the painter doesn't know the rules or doesn't respect them, the people won't like it. For some reason, they will dismiss it. In this way, you can be wrong. Even if they don't know the rules, they will. It works on mostly on mind level, this being wrong in art. But in a way that you can represent the figure, the face of a person in every way you want, and it still will be a face, an image of a face, because it won't be an actual face. You are not wrong then, because you can do it in every way, but people won't like it in every way, I guess. That's what you were...
Well, 17th century art theory said the contrary, that people like images which are not rationally done because they have no proper knowledge. I mean the mess. But that's just a historical. But actually, I have a question regarding this, how you put together the historical perspective on image making with a contemporary perspective that you're using, and you're using notions from neuropsychology and about image making and about image reception. But those don't always stand together with what I come from early modern studies, so I have examples in mind from that area. And how, even from the Renaissance, for example, you showed us Leonardo, and what he thinks about images is very different from what Michelangelo, his contemporary, would, and the relation between the mental image and the process of creating by drawing, the manual, the procedural stage. And he would actually, what you said about the mental image preceding the proper drawing, Michelangelo would totally agree, but Leonardo would probably say the contrary. And Leonardo, Michelangelo talks about the idea behind, which can never be put into on paper, on stone, whatever. But Leonardo, who actually never uses the word idea, he would actually treat drawing, and he talks about this, as a means to get away from the idiosyncrasies of his mind, maybe. Or the mental image that he would be tempted to go towards. So I think there are very different ways of looking at this relation. And how do you deal with a modern perspective about image making in dealing with objects which were produced from people from different cultures or from the same cultures, but using completely different sets of ideas about these relations?
Do you think the way in which Leonardo thought about art modified his art?
result that we see very highly depending on the way he thinks about art.
On a
people
conscious
think
and analytic level. No, what I'm trying to say is that yes, so what you see from the world, what you understand of the world is culturally dependent, right? On a certain level, because you are used to having a certain approach to things, so you see a thing because you know it's a thing and you work on it, or you discover a thing. But what I'm trying to work on is how much of the image is actually made in our mind, and how much is made on paper, basically. Because in our mind it's more or less visual than on and on the paper it ends up most of the time being slightly different than our concept. And of Leonardo and Michelangelo,
they have
different approaches. They have different styles. If you are a person who knows art, you will see that is clearly a Leonardo, that is clearly a Michelangelo. You can't confuse them. But if you are a random person, you will see that's Renaissance, maybe, or the image looks like a portrait, a realistic-ish portrait. I work more on an understanding of how we end up making images, because we end up making them in different, very different way, different of what we think of them, different of.
That's what I was trying to say. That it differs so much. Can you apply a schema?
Thinking scheme. I'm trying to apply it based on what we know of how our minds think, how we function. Sorry, how the mind functions, works. And the mind works just as well from the first, oldest discovered paintings until now. We have the same tools in creating our, and we have the same tools in basically making them. It's really limited in what we work with, and yet the results are varied and vary from culture and a little from one artist to another, but more on culture, like historical cultural background. But in the end, they use the same processes. That's my idea, that in the end we use the same process of making it, even though we end up making it different, because we think of the world as being different. I see the world in a certain way, and a Maori person will see the world in a different way. And well, I don't know, though, the ones with the split representation, is they don't split represent a bear because they see it from tail to head to tail. They still see it like me or you, but that's their concept of a bear.
But I mean, isn't it the case also that when you have objects, external objects, that changes your capacity, your brain function as well? So that because we've had a tradition of representational painting, the way we see things, the way we understand depth, for example, mm-hmm. within our own field of vision, is very different from a culture that has never developed like point perspective. So that actually so painting makes us allow us to use our eyes in a different way.
Yes.
Like civilizationally, just different. Like, so it has this cognitive addition, right?
I don't think it's an addition. I think it's a different approach, because in the same way we can't understand the split representation, and when we first see it and you don't know anything about it, it's like a decorative pattern or something, but that guy will see a bear. And I'm seeing something that's decorative. So it's basically a different way.
Well, I would say that in that sense, it also has another way in which it's similar to science, right? Mm-hmm. So with increased scientific education, we actually see the world differently than people who didn't know about, gravity or whatever.
Yeah, they had some concept of why stuff don't go up
or,
from the world.
I don't know,
like
blue, you know, like being able to identify colors.
Yeah, but some cultures are able to identify colors that, and we aren't. Mm. And also, I know it's a problem with the blue, but it's more like they didn't have a word for it in the antiquity, because they didn't produce it mechanically. The Egyptians had, the Greeks didn't have a word for blue, so it was either greenish or violet, it was somewhere in the area, but that didn't mean they didn't see blue, they just named it differently.
Different. Well, for example, this is like something that happened in the early modern periods, that color began to stand on a totally different scientific basis. You know, whereas perhaps in the past it had something to do with the concrete representation of, based on the minerals that you had to find somewhere in the Himalayas or something like that, right?
Yeah.
Whereas now it's just a spectrum of light. And so you switch.
Yeah, it's a different
way of using
the external world. Use the light color or the pigment color. It's different ways of using properties of the world.
Right. But what I mean is that things stop being of a color, but rather they simply, it's an interaction with white light.
Yeah.
With all the colors. So.
Yeah, it's not an interesting property of the object, but more is how the object interacts with the world, you know. But, and that's why using certain devices you can change the color of the object, make weird stuff with it. But actually, when you paint a face, you don't have the concept of what the face is colored like. You don't have a color on the face. In every portrait ever, you will see a mixture of a lot of colors to give the impression that is the color of a face, and has nothing to do with the actual interaction with your light in your face. It's completely different object from it. I think it's more about using the world, the external world, using properties